guys, it's your girl TayJordan. This is the Nitty Gritty Show. Shout out to my guest who's not here with me today. They are on a romantic getaway in the Bahamas. Shout out to Katniss and Jay. I'm really excited about today's show though. I got my brothers here with me, some very bright young men, on way and about to graduate from law school, get their Juris Doctorate, very excited about that, and I'm probably won't do it any justice. I'm going to let you guys introduce yourselves. Chima, I'm going to start with you.
What's going on, world? I am Chima Okoli, soon to be law school graduate by the grace of God, and I'm definitely happy to be here, happy to chop it up, you know what I'm saying, with the one and only TayJordan, and let's see where it takes us.
Yeah, and my name is Amore Okamina. I'm a former educator. Soon I also get a law degree. I'm really excited to engage in some discussion. I know Tay always brings that fire, so.
Always got that fire.
And you know what? Once an educator, always an educator. So
certainly.
Definitely. So as I mentioned before, I'm happy to have these guys. They always have rich perspectives that I'm always hungry to, you know, get their what they have to say out there. So. As you guys know, the Nitty Gritty Show is a diversity of thought, an exchange of thoughts, and we talk about everything, get down to the nitty gritty and issues as it pertains to our community at large, but also we talk some fun stuff. So today's show, we got a nice lineup. We're going to start things off with getting into this whole Kendrick Lamar, and man, my man's just dropped a dope album. I'm not sure if you guys had the opportunity to listen to it, but we're going to get into that, talk about him versus the feminist community. They was coming at his neck on Twitter and social media.
Excuse me.
Oh, yeah, no worries. And we're also going to get into the Gilbert Arenas and the colorism issues. It's 2017, but we're still dealing with colorism in America. We're also going to get into some fun stuff and talk NBA playoffs, my favorite thing to discuss, NBA basketball. But with no further ado, first things first, if you guys, unless you've been living under a rock, you probably are, you know, got wind of the story. There's two black judges dead in a week. The one judge, her name is Sheila Abdus-Salam. She was the first Muslim judge to be on the bench over in New York. She's a New York associate judge at the Court of Appeals. She was found floating in the Hudson River. They're ruling it a suicide. You know, obviously I'm reading the same details as you guys are reading. To me, in my opinion, I feel like it's a dead cut on the line somewhere. She was 65 years old. Her husband reported her missing. A day later, she's found, you know, floating in the river. And the other black judge was actually his culprit, his shooter, has actually been arrested. This was he was a Chicago circuit judge, and he was killed on his porch. It was a, you know, senseless act of violence. But two totally unrelated incidents. Actually, I want to play the clip. Kyle, you got me. We're going to run that clip and talking about the death of Judge Sheila Abdus-Salam.
Well, officials in New York are investigating the mysterious death of the country's first female Muslim judge. The body of Sheila Abdus-Salam was found floating in the Hudson River on Wednesday, one day after her husband filed a missing persons report. The 65-year-old was one of seven judges in New York State's highest court. Police say they've so far not found any evidence of an attack.
All right, so yeah, that was a report in regards to the judge that was found dead in Hudson River. Actually, yeah, I do want to introduce my brother who just walked in. Jordan J. Kill just walked in the building. Say hello.
How's everyone doing?
Everything's good. So let's talk about this. Were you guys familiar with the story as far as the judge found dead?
Yeah, I read about it. About it, and it is very tragic. In fact, just keeping up with the details, I know there was no sign of trauma, and she was found in like her jogging clothes and whatnot. But
yeah, it's kind of fishy to me. I mean, I'm no conspiracy theorist or anything like that, but I mean, I understand. You know, sometimes foul play is real. Chima, what's your thought on that? Do you think it was very well a suicide, or do you think that it's something more there, and investigators need to do a little bit more digging?
Well, I think when anybody loses their life, the maximum effort of the law needs to be applied to figuring out what happened. Just her being, you know, I believe is the first Muslim and the first female judge in New York. Just her stature, her prominence, I think would warrant that. A lot of times it's ruling something a suicide is the easiest way to say open and shut case. And truth be told, we'll never, you know, I think only her and the killer or whoever else was at the scene at the time knows, but I definitely believe just due to who she was, and I'd have to look into her track record and see more, but I'm really, like I said, wary of initially saying, all right, it's a suicide, let's close up shop. I think something needs to be done more here. Mm-hmm. And given the current state of this country and our political climate, everything needs to be explored.
I would agree that there. I think that everything needs to be explored and no stone needs to be left unturned in this investigation. Jordan, what's your whole take on the situation?
I agree 100%, actually. I think even looking at her type of cases that she sat on, look at the history, just to dig more deeper into, because I think me and Amore were just talking about this, I think last night, was how often do judges get killed, or...
Right?
Very rare.
It's a very rare thing, so I think it does need a little more than just a write-off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we're definitely going to be keeping our eyes on that and, you know, see where that case goes. I know early preliminary, they're saying suicide, but hopefully they do their due diligence and we get some answers. I'm not sure if they've conducted an autopsy report or anything just like that, but definitely going to keep our eyes on that and see what's to come. And... go from there. So I wanted to get into, you know, Kendrick Lamar just dropped his fourth LP. Damn. Made everybody say damn with just about. But before, you know, he released his album this past Friday, his lead off single was Humble, and that garnered a lot of criticisms, especially on social media, particularly from the Black feminist movement. That within itself, I find, is kind of interesting as far as the whole Black woman, Black feminist thing, because for quite a few reasons. I want to get into it, though. Criticism was steered from his lyrics in the single Humble. And his lyrics read, I'm so fucking sick and tired of the Photoshop. Show me something natural like Afro on Richard. I didn't do that. I'm not a lyricist, so I might not read it the same, but let me start over. I'm so fucking sick and tired of the Photoshop. Show me something natural like Afro and Richard Pryor. Show me something natural like ass with some stretch marks. So that obviously is seen as though he's bigging up women in the whole, you know, natural hair and natural movement and stuff like that. But then, you know, you can't make everybody happy. So you got women that's coming at him. It's like, you know, who is Kendrick Lamar to be telling us how we need to, you know, wear our hair, natural this, unnatural that, weave this, not weave that. So I wanted to get you guys, as a Black man, get you guys perspectives on the whole. First, the comments, or the lyrics. Did you see something wrong with it? And two, if you could speak on the outrage about it from the feminist movement. Oh, I'll start with you.
Oh, well, I think it's probably a manifestation of privilege for any man to be able to say, well, I see that or I do not see it. Mm-hmm. You know, because the way privilege works, it gives you the opportunity to choose to be affected or not affected. So, I mean, as a man, I think once it was brought to my attention and pointed out by people who took a different view, it was incumbent on me to think about really what are the implications. And having thought about it, I think Kendrick Lamar points out a real issue when mm-hmm. you talk about self-identity, self-perception, this question of beauty or women's beauty, mm-hmm. but I don't think he does a good job at providing any solutions. If anything, just talking about it in that way only contributes to the further objectification of women in terms of the lyric places Kendrick Lamar at the center. Mm-hmm. You know, show me something. Mm-hmm. And the issue with the patriarchal construct is that, you know, the man is at the center and then, you know, women and everyone else has to like bow. Mm-hmm. You know, and be subject to the gaze or be subject to whatever, be it natural or I don't know what the opposite of that is. But I see where he's going with that. But it just speaks to also society's grappling with the same issue. So Kendrick Lamar, by talking about it, has put himself right in the middle of it. But I don't believe that the lines themselves are constructive.
Okay. Yeah. So you don't think, you know, you think his intent can be good, but the way as far as how he's conveying his message is not necessarily the best.
Exact. Possibly. I don't know what Kendrick Lamar's intent is. I wouldn't even claim to know, but in terms of how it comes off and having seen the video, the way mm-hmm. it was depicted, it speaks to the objectification of women in hip hop, which mm-hmm. has been a problem for decades now. So mm-hmm. he's just continuing a trend that has been going on. But he's speaking on a real issue. I think mm-hmm. women, self-concept, feeling beautiful, and this it's become something of, I've heard it described as a nebulous thing that can never really be attained. Mm-hmm. And it's a subjective definition. I know I'm talking a lot about this, but it's a subjective definition, beauty. You know, mm-hmm. what is beautiful? Mm-hmm. And I think when you look at all the political factors that weigh in on how beauty or how people are put in a hierarchy, mm-hmm. then we run into trouble of, you know, your skin color, how your skin looks, mm-hmm. stretch marks or not. If he wanted to provide a solution, you know, let's just have less talk and more doing. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel like action speaks louder. So if you want some representation that you want to show more of, just show it, as opposed mm-hmm. to, you know, show me it's about like what I want. You know,
mm-hmm. so. Yeah, that's interesting you said that, because even if you look at the lyrics or look at the video, during that line, it shoots to, I guess I would call it a ambiguous young lady. I think that she's black, but the young lady, she didn't have an afro. She didn't have, you know, what he was referring to in the lyrics, which I thought was very interesting, is that, you know, if you're going to say this, that, you know, your video should reflect this. I mean, K-Dot is not one of the, he's not somebody that, you know, he's not an activist. I don't know why people are looking at him to be some type of women's empowerment speaker or anything like that. I mean, he's no stranger to the bitch word and stuff like that. I mean, it's hip-hop. Obviously, there's a lot of misogyny and stuff in hip-hop. It reminds me of the old saying my mom used to tell me, if you don't have nothing nice to say, don't say nothing at all. But I do think that it was blown out of proportion. So, Jay, I want to go to you in terms of from the feminist movement. I know even on my Facebook, I get into a lot of these discussions as far as, like, I guess black men in particularly have a negative outlook on the feminist movement and where it exactly comes from. So can you speak a little bit about that, your views on the feminist movement, and do you think that they're kind of like nitpicking with this song?
I think definitely it was blown out of proportion. Mm-hmm. I don't think his intent was to put anyone down or mm-hmm. to even objectify women. I think it was we in hip hop have heard the opposite of this so much. You know, we want the vixens, we want the supermodels, plastic mm-hmm. surgery, all that type of stuff. And for him to ask for something different, and them to put him down for it, to shoot him down for it. It's like, really? You know, all this other music speaks to putting you guys down, and him just wanting you to be, yourself, or the natural you, you mm-hmm. know, with the stretch marks. No, don't get plastic surgery. That's how you came. That's how I want you. Mm-hmm. And even when you speak to, like, the girl in the video not having the afro, I think it was just the split screen was to show, mm-hmm. you know, the makeup and the non-makeup, mm-hmm. you know. And he's done that a lot in his videos in the past. I've seen, like, the growth of him as an artist. So I can see that it's almost to play devil's advocate. And mm-hmm. as Amore was saying, he did. He places himself in the middle of it by doing that. So mm-hmm. he should be ready for what's to come to him.
Right.
And be ready to answer to why he said what he said. And
yeah,
that's as far as the feminist movement, I think there's a lot bigger of issues to address mm-hmm. when it comes to our women in hip hop and music mm-hmm. than someone asking you to be natural.
Okay.
I don't think he was trying to say that all you guys should, when I'm coming around, I want all you guys to be like this. Mm-hmm. You know, I just think it's a perspective that no one wants to talk about. So I thought it was great. Mm-hmm. You know, and then Be Humble, the whole song, it's kind of like the hidden message behind all of it. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, I thought it was a genius song. Can I jump
on that?
Yeah, definitely.
Really quickly, I couldn't agree with Jordan more. I think you have to look at the reason why women feel the need to get plastic surgery and why women feel the need to hide parts of their body. It's because they feel like they don't measure up to a standard. Mm-hmm. And personally, when I heard this line, he's saying, you know, if that's your hair and that's the way it grew out of your head, that's cool with me. And if that's how you look when you wake up in the morning, that's okay. you don't need to hide who you are, just be yourself. So like the fact that this line caused trouble, telling him, it's almost like, what if he said, I'm so tired of these natural women, show me some no stretch marks, show me some straight right. hair, and show me, you know,
the surgery.
It would be trouble. So quite frankly, I almost can't believe that this line, show me something natural, you show me yourself before you doctor, edit, or change. So I couldn't believe that this line caused controversy, because I believe he was speaking to the exact opposite of something that would anger anyone talking about the denigration of women.
Can I say something? I think that, and I don't disagree with either of you guys, but I just want to say that I think part of the feminist position is that it's not really a man's place to police a woman either way, good or bad. You know, so by positioning yourself as a cheerleader, you could be doing some harm, just like in a racial context, a person who is supposedly an ally could still be causing harm, even while they're trying to help out. So I've heard that, and I was like, well, you know, if it was a woman saying that, then that'd be different. But it's a man. Is it really a man's place? Either way, to
even say if he was just stating his opinion.
Even and he has, and that's why I said I don't disagree with you, because he's entitled to his opinion. But as far as like the issue of self-identification that women may be struggling with, I don't think men come in as a savior in either situation. It's just like the problem was created by men, you know. So the idea that men are going to solve it it can be problematic. I could just see that.
So is it fair that if it started, the issue is started by men, would it not be fitting for them to come with the solution?
So let's look at the racial context. Mm-hmm. You have racism that started by one race. Is it for that race? Are we to wait for that race to give us the final say on what the solution is?
I don't think
is?
You should wait, but I do think that you play a major role when you say.
True indeed, but do you have a right to have an issue with that if someone who is from maybe the oppressor race telling you what you ought to be doing and how you ought to be fixing your oppression.
I can see what you're saying.
I can see somebody having a legit issue with that, saying, well, no, you don't get to tell me how I do anything.
I see what you're saying.
So for that reason, I say, well, you know, that's equally valid.
Yeah. I see the point that you make. I think I would have to agree with Chima and Jordan, though. Just as a woman, I personally was embarrassed with the harsh criticism that Kendrick received for this line. I look at it as if, you know, you can't win for losing. Some people are obviously going, yes, Kendrick, natural women, yes. We want these women to, you know, stop feeling the need to, you know, go, you know, surgically enhanced, or I wouldn't even say enhanced.
They're dying every day.
Yeah, like, I do agree with you. I think it stems and it's rooted. It comes from a male place, why women feel pressure to go, you know, keep up with these European standards and whatever the standard may be for that particular year, whether it be ass shots, whether it be big breasts, stuff like that. But in terms of the criticism, I feel like you mentioned, that we got such bigger fish to fry, and it's much bigger issues than a guy telling you, like, hey, I'm cool with your natural hair, I'm cool with the natural, you know, show me some stretch marks. Would we rather have heard him say, you know, go get an ass shot, then talk to me? And it's like, ooh, like, you know, I feel like we hooray and we highlight the wrong things and turn up to the wrong things. Then it's the things that it's like, hey, this is actually quite positive. But it's like, and the whole thing about, you know, it's not the male's place to police a woman, I understand that, but I feel like you got to take the good with the bad. You can't just say, I want a male to be my cheerleader. I think that both of us are open to both cheerleading and criticism.
True. I think in terms of accountability, it's interesting that he's speaking to women and not men. If men are the ones who cause this issue, you know, talk to the guys. Hold the guys accountable.
I agree with that for sure.
So that's kind of like where I'm a little hesitant and a little suspect with it all.
Yeah. Okay. I'm happy you brought up that point, because that's actually a perfect segue into our next topic. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with Tyrese. He's always the one to, he's not shy on social media, always sharing his ideals, as chauvinist as they can be. So he just took a lot of flack for, you know, obviously he has, what is this, the 7th, 8th, Fast and Furious movie out, so he's going on his promo run.
35th one.
I know, right? It's like, sit it down already. But I guess they figured, like, if, you know, they keep buying tickets and keep selling out in the box office, why not keep creating it? But anyway, I wanted to get into what Tyrese said. So he's going on this press run in which he spoke to BET, and he had some interesting things to say. I want to read that quote. in which he was really dragged in the mud for on social media. So this is what he says. This is a quote. "I appreciate all the ladies out there that are still single, that are holding out. Don't settle. Don't settle. Though this message didn't start out offensive, things... Oh, okay. I'm going to tell you all right now, and this might be harsh. Sluts, skeezers, hoes, tramps, and overly aggressive promiscuous women, they are never without a man because they don't have no standards. They ready to have sex with any and everything that want to have sex with them. You have women that are active out in these streets. They going to lunches and dinners every night, private planes, mega yachts. It's cracking. They're never without. However, it comes with a cost. You're going to put a lot of miles on yourself down there. Come on." So that's what he said. And social media, Black Twitter, Black women Twitter went crazy. So Wendy Williams went crazy as well. That's exactly how it sounded. It was like a Funkmaster Flex dropped bombs on it. So he issued an apology after, you know, Wendy Williams kind of took it to him on his show, on her show. So this is his apology. He says, "My mother taught me better than this. Lesson learned. In life, you will learn that it's not always what you say is how we choose to say it. For the record, I'm far from a misogynist, a male chauvinist, or flat out mean. My intentions were there, but my delivery fucking horrible, and clearly all the way off. And for that, I sincerely apologize to all the ladies. I have never experienced what I am experiencing right now. I've been getting dragged and feel the heat from any for my poor choice of words and approach to my messages. Trust me." Okay, so there's a lot there. So let's unpack this. Tyrese, as you guys mentioned, particularly you said that, you know, it's not really a guy's place to really police women. And this is a perfect example of a guy trying to police women. He spoke to promiscuous women, but he didn't bother to speak on, you know, obviously these women are not sleeping with themselves. They're sleeping with men. He didn't speak to those men, though. So what's your whole take on Tyrese's comments? And if you could just speak a little bit, it may not be your perspective that you identify with, but I'm sure it's a perspective that you've heard about. Obviously, it's a lot of women bashing and promiscuous and slut this, slut that, thought this, thought that. Just talk a little bit about that.
I would say that, agreed, 100%. I don't think it's a man's place, and this is obviously one of those situations where you see how a person could be so blinded by their privilege, even when he speaks about, well, it's a delivery, or my intent was this, my intent was that. My view is really that we're looking at forces that contribute or that perpetuate, you know, this issue of, you know, sexism, misogyny, patriarchy, because we men, in terms of like the public media, tend to dominate and control and criticize women, you know, for their own choices. I think his comments speak to also what he believes about sex and sexuality, but that doesn't mean every woman has to ascribe to that, or every man, so to speak, you know. It's not an uncommon view that women who enjoy sex or have multiple sex partners are somewhat less than. But I think it really boils down to what you believe. And I think for Tyrese to walk back his words, well, that might show maybe some appreciation for what kind of problems these comments can create. But you know, it's unacceptable. You can't. Okay. You don't get to just be, even if you believe that, you know, a person ought to wait till they're married to have sex. You know, others who do not believe that don't have to be subject to your viewpoint that you are entitled to. But you know,
right?
Yeah, I don't agree.
I hear you. Well, what about you, Chima? What's your thoughts on that?
Initially, when I heard him say this, obviously, I try not to get caught up in the firestorm of how things happen immediately when this is said. And obviously, I do feel that him trying to legislate morality on women, that's wide of the mark. However, I really looked at what he was saying, and I looked at the message of it saying, you know, I wouldn't try to speak for all men.
Right.
And I don't think you should try to speak for all of anyone. But he's saying, you know, to those women who have decided, you know what, and him being, I have to preface it with him being an entertainer and him seeing a lot of things probably in his day.
True.
He probably looked at it and said, you know what, to all the, you know, the girls who are not using men for their money to go on yacht trips or intentionally getting pregnant by professional athletes, the girls who are on their grind, pursuing their dream, in school, holding it down, like, don't think that because what they have is gold per se, that it's, you know, it's not hollow. But I do feel that if you're going to address a platform like a topic like that from your platform that you have, you can't do it in such a flippant manner. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I'm saying? Right. You can't just do it in like, oh, that puts a lot of miles down there. It's like, listen, Tyrese, you have enough money and enough influence. Why don't you hold a women's summit in L.A.? Mm-hmm. I'm assuming he's from L.A., correct, Jordan?
Yeah.
Well,
you know you can't trust those guys from L.A. anyways. But address it, you know what I mean? Address it in a serious way. But if I'm looking at the content of his message, mm-hmm. and if I have a daughter, I'm going to tell her something similar. Like, yo, value yourself. And of course you need to speak to the men. Like, absolutely. But in this particular thing, in this particular tirade, I'll call it, mm-hmm. he was talking to women. Right, does he have that right? No. But most men that I know, when you have a daughter or when you're seeking a long-term partner, you're going to look for a lot of those qualities. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? And truth be told, I believe that the core tenets of his message could have been conveyed in so much better of a way, because mm-hmm. once again, he doesn't have a right to legislate all women, but that's his opinion mm-hmm. on women that he likes. Mm-hmm. So I just wish he did it in a more serious way. And I feel his mama got on the horn like, yo, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And she kind of gave him a verbal whipping. And mm-hmm. His apology, in my opinion, was contrite. You know, it wasn't like the United CEO's apology, like, we regret what happened on our airline. We are taking steps to remedy the situation.
Yeah, thanks, bro.
You know what I mean? I really feel like he's like, man,
because
Tyrese used to be, he's the dude singing on the bus to the ladies. The ladies just love Tyrese. Mm-hmm. But he's not used to this. And that shows the power, you know, that of quote unquote black Twitter and, you know, black women in general. They're just like, nah, I'm like, you're out of line with this. Mm-hmm. And I feel that his apology was genuine because he did mm-hmm. feel that heat.
Yeah. But that's the thing, too. Why does it have to take, you know, people feeling the heat on their ass for them to actually be like, you know what? Well, geez, maybe you're right. I should have not said that. Let me apologize. So it becomes like this type of, you know, damage control type of thing. And I'm not saying his apology was that. Well, I mean, obviously, when you mess up in your target market, as you probably should issue an apology. But I would agree with you. I do think it was sincere.
What platform did he say this on?
So the initial post was actually on Instagram.
Okay. Yeah. You know, it's probably from his phone. He probably just thinking.
You know, Twitter fingers.
You know what I mean?
Lil Hennessy.
Exactly. You
something know. Else. Maybe you know, I'm a type of Instagram.
I agree with both of you guys. Actually, all you guys. I think that it wasn't his place, but the message, again, even with in the Kendrick situation, I think it was misconstrued a little bit because of the way he conveyed it. I think the message was more value yourself. Mm-hmm. A lot of these women who are out here having sex with multiple people, yeah, they might have a boyfriend, a husband, mm-hmm. but you, the women, the single woman that's actually, you know, her body is a tipple to her. Mm-hmm. Shout out to y'all. I think right. that's what.
But did he have to put the promiscuous women down to big ups the women that is, you know, holding out and not being as promiscuous?
He did not, but then society already puts them on a higher pedestal. It's like no guy wants to, I don't know, date a prude girl. That's the idea. It's like, mm-hmm. oh, she's not having sex mm-hmm. with me, then I'm moving on. Mm-hmm. And then he's like, but that's not the case. The better women are the one that holds out. So shout out to y'all.
And I'm see,
like,
I'm happy.
The comparison might have been needed, but uh-huh. he could have did it a lot better.
Right. And in terms of bigging up those women that are, you know, I guess the polar opposite of the women that are held to a pedestal and highly, I guess was popular and highly regarded. But I feel as though as a woman, as a black woman, a lot of times I feel as though we're receiving mixed signals and mixed messages. You got on one end guys like Kendrick Lamar and Tyrese would say, oh yeah, shout out to you girls that's, you know, y'all different. Shout out to y'all. Y'all go get shows. Then on the other end, you got even guys like Kanye West who said the same thing. Hmm. Then in your real life, it just does not mirror what you actually say. So it's like, which one is it? Are you saying these things that sound good? Or do you actually believe them? You know, don't tell me you want, you know, to do this and go to school and blah, 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 blah. But I turn around and I look at the numbers and I see a lot of black women that's 30 and above, highly educated, unmarried. But I see, you know, the women with the ass shots, loving hip hop women, you know, they got their rings. Mm-hmm. So like, what's really going on here? Which one is it?
Yeah, I have a lot of opinions about this. I think one is that you often don't find women, or you don't find men being held to some of the standards that mm-hmm. women are being held to, particularly when it comes to sex and, you know, the number of sexual partners. It's rarely a disqualifier for a man in terms of how desirable he is. But it can be a very big marker for, you know, mm-hmm. for a woman, whether or not she's desirable. And I think that might even speak to a huge insecurity amongst males when it comes to this question of sex and sexuality and feeling sexually exclusive. But I think because men prize that, that is now held over women as, hey, this is more valuable. But I think in a world where women are making their own decisions, then it'll be up to them to decide, you know, their self-worth and not be chained by their choices, because men make these choices all the time without a thought. It's never, I mean, and I'm not speaking just for myself. I'm just speaking for what I've seen and observed. I think it's sort of a bit hypocritical when men start saying stuff like, you know, who has she been with, blah, 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 that makes her not as good as this person. I mean, even, and I would speak even as someone who will be a father one day, you know, talking to my daughter, like my brother here was talking about, it's going to be up to me to let her know that she probably has to make her own choices, you know? The idea that it's a man's place to make sure his daughter is pristine and chaste, and these are, they have a history, you know? This is rooted in, you know, the 15th, 16th century birth of patriarchy in the West, in the Western world. So I'm always suspect about these. And also, Tyrese does have a movie coming out. So, like,
right,
the more mentions he gets is good for his.
Yeah, it's like, you know, Pepsi. So. No press is bad press, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so I do want to transition into our next topic. And, you know, staying on this, you know, black man, black woman. If you guys are, we usually do a To Hell With, and this week the To Hell With, it's kind of like similar to, I guess, Donkey Other Day on Breakfast Club. So the To Hell With is a segment in the show where we say to hell with a person in the culture that's just out here cooning and not, and just acting a fool. So this week's To Hell With goes to none other, he actually gonna get the award quite often, Gilbert Arenas, and sad to say that Agent Zero was one of my favorite players growing up, and I gotta drop the kid, man. Like, the NBA dropped him. I'm dropping him from my list because, you know, sometimes when a person starts opening their mouth, you realize how ignorant they are. And it's like, man, I can't support this dude on or off the basketball court. So Gilbert Arenas gets this week To Hell With, mainly because, if you guys do not know, this past week, Gilbert Arenas was, again, under fire on social media because he's quite a frequent on social media, particularly Instagram and his shenanigans. So in an Instagram post, he replied to the Twitter handle, not Twitter handle, the IG handle is Pro Black Thought. They posted a picture that says, Dear Black Girl, you don't have to be mixed to be beautiful. So him comment creeping, he comes in and he writes a dissertation under the image in which he says, how black are we talking? Not to be funny, can you name a beautiful black woman on the outside? Not brown skin like Tyrese Black. Top 50 most beautiful women of all time. The darkest women they have is Keisha Knight Pulliam, a.k.a. Rudy, Gabrielle Union, Terrell Hicks from Belly, Serena Williams. When you say African features, black, then you have one, Lupita Nyong'o, and she's cute when the lights are off. Second is Adjumina Nasayana, and she's an actress as well. He says, sorry, but ew. So the black beautiful woman you try to boost up is technically light-skinned or brown-skinned. So it's a lot to unpack there. Obviously, you know, the colorism issue is 2017, but it's still an issue in black America. You could say that it's rooted from slavery, Jim Crow. We're still dealing with it. Willie Lynch. Whatever you say the root is, it's 2017. We're still dealing with it. So I wanted to get you guys' perspective, not only just his comments, but the fact that this is still being said by our black, I'm not saying that he represents all black men, of course not. Of course not all black men is ignorant as Gilbert Arenas. But can you guys talk a little bit about how does this happen? Like, how does he even feel like the green light to actually come out and say stuff like this? Because these type of comments are coming quite frequently. Just 2 weeks ago, it was a football player that went on a tirade on social media as far as black women are not coachable. So I guess my question is, this clash of colorism within the black community, how can we get rid of it, and why is it still existing? Jay, we start with you.
Okay. First, speaking to, I guess, Gilbert Arenas, I don't know why we value so much what he has to say, to be honest. I remember when I was in my baccalaureate, in my graduation, one of the preacher came up and he said, the black community confuses black celebrities with the black heroes.
These black celebrities have platforms, though.
They do, but that doesn't mean they care about you. That doesn't mean they're for their people. And these usually the people in the NBA, the top 1% of college athletes, they're in the NBA. They go to these huge PWIs. And at the PWIs, they get put on pedestals by white people. And I feel like that's where they lose that identity of that black is beautiful. It's like,
is that us giving them an excuse, though, to be ignorant?
It's like when you get mad if these athletes dating white women. And but that's what they see. Like, that's the easy route for them, you know? They'd rather have a puppet than someone to have intellectual warfare with. And he's been so far removed. I think the money probably got him removed, or whatever it is. I think the removal of that from wherever, where is Gilbert Arenas from?
Not sure exactly.
So I feel like whatever, I know they're probably getting a lot of backlash too, wherever his hometown is, because like, you know, your grandma's his color. Your mother's this color. You this color.
Yeah, he issued an apology. I guess it was his, I don't know if it was his mom or one of his family members, he said, you know, got on his case and made him do an apology. And his apology was half-assed. I'll read that as well. But,
but yeah, I think we're giving him.
Yeah, he's from L.A. I wanted to say that. I just wasn't too sure.
Ain't that so crazy?
What part is he from?
Your hood.
See,
he's look, from your hood.
He's from your block. That's your man. He's from
California. They do it even more. I feel like in this whole Hollywood mindset, you kind of just, you get shown what's beautiful in California, and it's curly and it's light. And I feel like I think that's what he fell victim to. And I think we need to stop putting his words on the pedestal and put
people. See, my issue with that in terms of putting, I don't necessarily see it as us putting his words on a pedestal. I think it's just more so us holding him accountable for the platform that he has and him misusing it. You know, I'm not saying that you got to go out here and be, you know, Malcolm X or, you know, some type of activist. That's fine. Everyone is not socially conscious, and that's fine. It's not your it's not everybody's responsibility to be that, especially athletes.
Yeah.
A lot of the job realistically is to dribble a basketball. I get that. But at the same time, once you put yourself out there, you open up yourself for ridicule and for criticism, and he definitely, rightfully so, I think, you know, was heavily criticized as he should have been. But my question, and Chima, I'm going to take this to you. When black men say these type of things and, you know, go on these, I'm the type of person, I'm very self-aware and I do a lot of self-reflection. So, you know, for one, when I type something, I'm probably going to proofread it. And then I'm probably going to check for the voice, the tone, see if it's like, should I really say this? Because at the end of the day, it's a reflection. What you put out there in osmosis, is you got to deal with that. So my question to you is, why do so many black men in particular feel the need, or I guess feel like they got the open season to say these type of things about black women? And my question to you also is, where's black men checking each other about this?
Agreed. And I'm really happy you came to me and listened. I guess the first thing I have to say is prefacing it by exactly what Jordan said. Just because this person has a lot of money and can play basketball well does not mean he speaks for the black community. And it's sad, because it's like, now if, let's say, and regardless of how you feel about their ideology, Michael Eric Dyson says something, okay, or Cornel West says something, it's like, all right, you know, that I could understand that they've devoted their lives to the betterment and the empowerment of black people. This guy just plays basketball.
But Colin Kaepernick, it's a two-edged sword. When you got somebody like an athlete like Colin Kaepernick that does something positive and we hooray and celebrate him, you got to look at the people that's also athletes and they say something bad, and we got to deal with that as well. We can't just highlight one and, oh, he said something we like. The one that said something we didn't like, yeah, he doesn't matter. He's just an athlete.
Not for sure. And that's the thing. If there was a black person right now that told me they didn't agree with Colin Kaepernick, I'd be like, man, I wish you did, because personally I do, but I could understand, because he doesn't speak for you either. You get what I'm saying? And it's almost like Jordan had said, he's so far removed from the average black man in America. For example, I watched the documentary that they had on OJ, and this is the big criticism with OJ. There was a table with a bunch of white people. He was the only black person there, and the black people section of the banquet was a couple of tables over, and OJ turns to his boy and goes, hey man, they don't even notice I'm black. And he goes, you kidding, right? He's like, no, I'm not black, I'm OJ. You get what I'm saying? So the money and the status, and that gave him this, you know, platform to, when he looks out, he's like, okay, well, you know what? In my life, XYZ is applicable. And sadly, people who give these, Kim Kardashian, what has she done to become famous? Huge platform, global platform. You know what I'm saying? No, we know what she's done, and most people wouldn't consider that a Nobel laureate. You know what I'm saying?
She got a ring.
She got a ring on her, yeah, it was only her seventh try. You know what I'm saying?
She got seven of them.
Now, when you say got, but we're going to move on. Sorry. We're going to move on. God don't like ugly. You see that? But yeah, you know, I just don't believe.
I'm not sure it was seven either. It might have been three.
It might have been 10. I just don't believe that because this person is a rich, famous athlete, that he speaks for all black men. Yes, he has a big platform. And yes, he's out of line. But you also got to realize when your drunk uncle at the cookout says some wild stuff, man, that's just Uncle Chris, man. He get like that. You know what I mean? That's kind of how people dismiss it. And just because Uncle Chris is a millionaire with a big platform doesn't mean that he can paint this brush broadly and be like, the black delegation has spoken. Dark-skinned women are not attractive. Who do you think you are, buddy? So your reality is not the average black man's reality. So I don't believe he should be able to speak for the average black man.
But is that kind of we are granting those type of people, like you mentioned, the drunk uncle, he always talk like that. If we disregard people and give them a pass and, you know, let them, hold them not accountable for their actions, isn't that problematic within itself? Yes. Is that really helping us? If you know, you spread around, you spoil a child. Like, if you don't nip something in the bud as it happens and you just disregard it and turn the other cheek, well, you don't speak for me anyway. Like, what is that really the solution that we're rocking with?
Let me say one more thing about that. So, and I'm also glad you brought that up because, like you said, all right, so in what manner should we discipline this man for his conduct? Quote, right? Mm-hmm. You have to realize, you have to look at, why is he on a random Instagram? This man who has $40 million in the bank, right? Mm-hmm. Why are you on a random Instagram page typing a paragraph to attack black women? Mm-hmm. He's clearly begging for this attention. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And it's not as if we can take him to moral court and be like, hey, man, your comments were so egregious and so heinous, we're going to take $80 million out of your bank account. We can't do that. Mm-hmm. The way that we censor it and the way we discipline it is like, all right, man, thank you for your opinion. Next. He clearly was looking for attention. This wasn't something that somebody overheard earlier this year. And I have a couple of friends who still play professional football. So earlier this year, he did, he kind of shed light on a very common thing that you go to strip club, you take out $60,000 in ones, but you don't sign any of the receipts. Mm-hmm. You call fraud on your account the next day, you get all your money back.
Mm. That's what Gilbert Arenas said?
He said that on Instagram. Wow. So you see me, this is the type of person we're dealing with. Like, I think he starved for the relevancy that his platform once garnered. Because once he got kicked out of the league, he played in China. And now he's just saying, hey, look at me, I have something incendiary to say. And I think that since we can't take his money or we can't censor him, taking it, compartmentalizing it, and kind of washing him away is the thing that we need to do.
Okay. I feel that.
I agree with both of these guys. You know, I couldn't agree more. I don't think he speaks for anybody here, nor does he speak for the blacks at large. I think one of the problems we have is that we, as black people, too often see ourselves through white eyes. Mm. So even our very concept of what is beautiful or what is desirable has been handed down and was created during a time where people were put in a hierarchy, where some humans were better than others, you know, everything down from the skin tone to the hair follicle. Mm-hmm. And it's no surprise that those things still, they still linger, you know, in 2017. Right. I think as far as any celebrity or anyone who's got a ton of followers, a couple of things, having a lot of followers does not make you a leader. You know, if you just think about that.
Say that again, please. Say that again, please. That's what I've been trying to say.
I'm going to have to quote that.
You know, flex, drop a bomb on that.
I really do think that. And additionally, you know, he's entitled to his opinion. But I love that we live in an age where people can be held accountable. I think accountability it cuts both ways. You know, we should hold Kaepernick accountable. And as you can see, he stood by what he believed. Mm-hmm. And when we hold a Gilbert Arenas or a Tyrese accountable, they don't defend that. You know, so on some level, you can also see like the accountability is a useful part of the conversation because they don't get the final say. Like, you know, yeah, you expressed your impulse or whatever it was that you were thinking, but now people can challenge that. And it's up to you to give us something more, you know, but it's indefensible. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't believe that measuring one human being against the other is ever going to get us to a point where we are living happier lives.
Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. Okay. quick follow up, and then I'm gonna move on to, you know, I know you guys want to talk some hoops. But quick question in terms of if we don't hold these, if we don't hold them accountable, I guess what really is going to stop them from saying such things is not going to stop. It's just something that we're always.
Well, personally, I don't think censorship is the direction mm-hmm. you need to go to in this mm-hmm. country. You know, mm-hmm. First Amendment, freedom of speech. You have a right to express. He's not calling for someone to get hurt or, you know, killed or anything.
So it's okay. Like, it's just his opinion. He can say he's entitled to his opinion.
He has a right to be a colorist.
So my next question is, in terms of, that's why I'm happy I got you guys up here. I got three educated black men, so I'm really, of course, value you guys' opinion. But the narrative that I always hear and I'm combating on Facebook is that, you know, well, he don't speak for us all. And I get that, of course not. But what would you guys, in your guys' honest opinion, what percentage of men do you think have these flawed colorism issues and these type of problematic perspectives?
Black men or men black generally? Men.
Like, what would you say we're really dealing with? Because I always hear the comeback like, well, all black men don't feel that way. And I'm looking at it like, you're right, but a large amount I do. I mean, as a dark-skinned woman, I hear a lot of, like...
If I even though personally I can't put a number on it, I will say that it's significant enough for it to be a problem. Mm-hmm. It's not like these are outliers. No, like there are probably a good amount of people who mm-hmm. are dealing with this and who are receiving viewpoints like mm-hmm. Gilbert Arenas or wherever it is. It's being subtly portrayed that, you know, certain looks are not quite good enough, mm-hmm. And having just effect on males and females, mm-hmm. affecting how some people are growing up and thinking. I think there's a cultural mm-hmm. issue as mm-hmm. well that we can't deny, that the culture itself does need to look at itself and look at how it is we are treating human beings.
So if it's not censorship, how can we, I guess, what type of solution is viable that we can get to, like, in terms of people are entitled to their opinions. They're going to say what they want to say. And I guess this is kind of how a cycle continues. I mean, Gilbert Arenas has children. I mean, he has friends. He has
two black influence. Daughters.
Yeah. So I guess my question is, what colorism is rooted to is, you know, up for debate. But no matter the source or the root of it, how can we change it? And is it going to be changed?
All right, well, two things I'm going to say, and I'm off this. One mm-hmm. is we can definitely change by presenting a counter-narrative. So just as you have people who are saying ignorant things, we need people who are going to be out there saying things that have insight. The second thing I'll say is we need to stop saying or looking at these people as spokespeople.
Yeah.
Because I think that is from the white perspective, as, okay, well, which one of you all has something to say? No, I don't really believe that. Literally. These people expressing their opinions as individuals, because uh-huh. If you think about it, there's the leader of the free world right now. He rants on Twitter all the time. Mm-hmm. And no one would say he's speaking for all white people. Mm-hmm. You know, that would be very reprehensible in a sense. Like, well, of course not. He's speaking for himself. So I think...
Speaking for a couple of them.
No, he's popular, but yeah.
He is speaking for a couple of them. No,
yeah, he could be. Let me down.
But I completely agree.
He is speaking for a couple. I agree 100%. But... Not all.
Right.
I know, absolutely.
Well, of course. I mean, that's the thing. When people make blanket statements and these broad generalizations, it obviously doesn't speak to the whole, but it speaks for a large amount, when you say.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I do want to... Did you guys have anything to add on that?
Yeah, at least for the... I think a lot of the big... Large part of it is, at least the issue, is what we support as a people and what we retweet and what we repost.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't really repost love, positivity, as much as we do negativity. That's mm-hmm. why he gets so much spotlight on this. It's because where's the random person saying, oh, black women are beautiful? Do they have 100 and, mm-hmm. you know, 100 million retweets as this guy does? Because mm-hmm. they love to highlight this and make this seem like this is the majority view of all of us, and it's really not. So
you would say we need to put the onus on ourselves to make the positive narratives popular.
Get this off my timeline. Yeah. I'm not about to retweet this. Like.
Yeah, agreed.
I feel that. But that, I think that it's strength in numbers. It never have to be a collective type of mindset for us to have. And I don't,
goes both ways. Yeah, strength in numbers.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Yo, just piggybacking off what Jordan said, like, I agree with that wholeheartedly. Like, you literally, all right, what do black people, and because it's obvious, right? Once black people say something's cool, it's cool. You have, once white people finally, and I don't mean white people in an incendiary way, but once the mainstream America, oh, this thing is called the dab. Oh, Hillary Clinton got a dab. Dab so much that it just made you sick to your stomach to see anybody doing it. Like, dang, we used to have something for the millionth time.
Take everything.
We had something that was cool that you guys ruined. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, if we take, like, yo, encouraging black people to be cool, if we had, imagine if it was, people would be like, yo, where you see that? Oh, I saw it on World Star. I'm like, bro, don't show it to me. I don't want to see, like, a stabbing or a fight or some dude get out of his car and hit somebody over the head with a baseball bat. I'm good on these negative reinforcement of black people. So if black people stopped laughing at it and thinking it was funny, we would change the narrative and change the culture of how people see and perceive us. And that's just that.
That's real. On that note, I definitely agree with that for sure. All right, guys. So as you guys know, this weekend kicked off the 2017 NBA playoffs.
On a lighter note.
Right, on a lighter note.
Soapbox off.
So as you guys know, I'm a Cleveland native. So, woohoo, defending champions. My Cavs not really playing championship basketball right now, though. Really? But
skated by.
Yeah. Activate shade.
Hold on now. Watch out. Until we are dethroned and until someone beats us, we are still champions. So put some respect on Cleveland Cavaliers. Exactly.
The land. All right.
Defend the land. Actually, you know, a shout out to my hometown out here. It's some very sad news taking place right now. A shooter on the large. Hopefully he is stopped. Absolutely. And brought to justice.
Definitely.
And arrested.
Prayers up for that.
Definitely prayers to blessings to my city. But getting back to the lighter note and talking basketball, let's talk this NBA postseason. I want to get you guys picks. Let's first talk the first round in the East. Obviously, who do you guys think is going to be the setup, or I guess the upset in both series, or not in both series, in both conferences? For the West, give me your setup, your upset. In the Eastern Conference, give me your upset.
That's tough. Okay, I can go first for the Utah. Might take Clippers, which is scary.
They did get the first win yesterday.
And that's going to be a whole momentum shift. Mm-hmm. I think what killed the Clippers most of the time is their momentum. If they lose momentum, they get down on themselves. Mm-hmm. They just start playing worse. And I would hate that for Chris Paul because I'm a big Chris Paul fan. And I think he just actually deserves a ring, or at least deserves a shot at it.
He at least deserved to get to the conference finals, at least.
Something, you know.
In the East Coast, I would love to say Pacers are going to upset the Cavs.
Come on, man. But, they're going to do it right there.
But you know, they might just lose to Boston. But I'm trying to think. Who? I'm not too sure about the East Coast just yet.
Mm-hmm. I do like that Milwaukee series. They're taking on the Toronto Raptors. And Toronto got the higher seed, but I think Milwaukee can upset them in the East. That's just my opinion.
Okay.
But Milwaukee did steal game one.
I don't think Toronto, they've always been highly ranked, but they've never been.
Yeah, it's like,
they just don't have enough.
Really,
exactly.
They don't
they've never had enough.
Like, yeah. who, like.
DeRozan from DeRozan. LA.
DeRozan.
He's from LA, chill out.
You know how to
bro, apparently everybody from LA is either just a bad influence or a basketball player. So this is good, bro.
Like James Harden, Westbrook, come on, you can't go along.
Nah, literally. I just want to jump there and say that everybody is sleeping, and not even sleeping, they're almost sleeping in plain sight on the Spurs. And I honestly feel like, hey, go ahead. The Spurs, listen, the Spurs will spur you to death. They will do Spur basketball. You ever notice if you watch the Spurs play, they never panic. They pass it around. They I'm a big other football fan. They remind me of Barcelona in the way that they never panic on the ball. They just keep passing it, whether they're down by 10, whether they're up by 10, and eventually that Popovich system. It's going to come at you. I mean, I do enjoy, you know, I'm a Wizards fan, but I know for a fact that A, making out of the East is a pipe dream, and then B, crossing over to the West is even tougher. But I definitely think the Spurs are going to upset people.
Okay. The Spurs, you know what, they're solid every year.
I do bang with LeBron, though.
I think San Antonio can possibly come out the West. Obviously, Golden State is the favorite. Actually, the series kicking off tonight, I think at 9 p.m. is keeping heavy looks on the Houston Rockets and Oklahoma City Thunder.
Yeah, yeah, series. That's going to be
very interesting. You got two former teammates. Two current MVP contenders going against each other. But so I want to talk about MVP too. Obviously, this has been a hell of a MVP race this year. Yeah, we got Russell Westbrook, who's probably the favorite. Well, some would say not the favorite because Harden his team is six in the East. Yeah. Harden is up there. Isaiah Thomas is up there. Of course, LeBron James, as he is every Zeke. Year. And Kawhi Leonard. So real quick, let's get everybody's MVP picks. If you had a vote on a committee, who you going with? Who's MVP this year?
Nobody's going to talk about Russell Westbrook in his room?
Does
he not play basketball anymore?
Has this man
not been literally breaking the necks of other men night after night? He's like Gladiator in there, man. This man is fighting lions. Yeah. This guy, I mean, and granted, the triple-double has been romanticized a bit, but it's still a mark of consistency to do that every single game. And granted, he doesn't have much help. But there's a lot of guys who don't have much help, and their team is just bad. Mm-hmm. Take away Russell Westbrook from that team, and they probably couldn't beat a really good AAU team.
Yeah.
So they're not good. Help. And he's been putting on every night. So I got to give it to him.
What about you, O? Who are you taking?
Same, Westbrook.
Westbrook. Hey, give me some.
I'm just saying.
Is this about to be unanimous, or are you about to mess it up?
You know. Okay. We're talking about most valuable player. I think if you did the same thing with Houston – and taking Harden out of that,
Houston got a better squad though. He got a better support.
But what he's giving them though, you know, he's giving them what 13 assists, almost 30 points. You know, that's just. But yeah, you know, I can't get past a point guard putting up big O numbers. You know?
Yeah, man, triple double for a season.
Come on, he's Oscar.
That's what I'm saying. You just like, beat Oscar Robertson. Like, come on, man.
To be honest, I'm a little bit more impressed with Russell Westbrook's season this year, more so than I was last year with Steph Curry's unanimous MVP.
Oh yeah,
season.
I agree. Yeah, I feel like if anything is unanimous, it has to be this year.
And
if he doesn't, it's going to be
a little foo foo.
I'm happy I'm not the only one.
Everybody know I'm banging with Russell. But that was a little
foo-foo. Yeah, I would agree.
Like, you guys not even going to take it to vote? Okay.
Huh?
But with Steph Curry, they didn't even take it to vote?
No, everybody voted for him. The whole nobody else got a vote. He was unanimous.
So, Jordan, who's your pick, bro?
I'm going to go with Westbrook. I think he will win. I think it's going to go to an L.A. cat regardless, so I'm not really mad.
I forgot he was from L.A. All
right, man. Hey, man. I mean, LeBron statistically is having his best season as well. Well, one of his better seasons. Averaging 8 assists, 25 points, and 8 rebounds.
Well, he got spoiled.
Isaiah Thomas has been doing something.
Well.
Yeah, take him off that team.
Tell you,
if you're going to go most valuable, all these players are so valuable, it's so hard to choose.
That's true.
You don't think we got spoiled with LeBron? This man's giving you blood, sweat, and tears. 6 straight finals. We're so used to him being really good that when he has another really good season, it's like, bro, that's just LeBron.
Right.
LeBron has been 14
straight seasons, averaging over 20 points.
Come on, man. You can't deny
that. I'm sure we're spoiled. But, guys, I thank you so much for appearing on the show today. It was a pleasure to have you guys.
Thank you so much for having me.
So this is the Nitty Gritty Show. Make sure you guys tune in next week. Next week we have a really good show as well, as we have DC's own. We have a comedian coming by. His name is Stickum Johnson, and definitely going to get into an interesting discussion with him. So make sure you guys check us out on Facebook, follow our page, like our page, I should say, at the Nitty Gritty Show on Facebook. You can also find us on Twitter at the handle TBJ_NittyGrittyShow. Again, I'm Tay Jordan. These are my brothers. We signing off. Peace and love, y'all.
Hey.